stuff that's in there that is actually I back to its normal shrinks in the hypertonic solution, and then you put it back in normal solution, it basically restores its shape and reconstructs the tissue. So it was a way of acutely detubulating the heart. So you have three conditions here, and normal are the heart, the heart failures are the open circles, and red is from the detubulated cells. Now,
used originally in the 70s by a whole bunch of And this accumulation occurs in the T-tubules, where you don't have rapid diffusion or equilibrium. And so you're changing the resting potential of the cell, in effect altering the ELK channel and altering the action potential. So as you change T-tubule density, you're also affecting this extracellular potassium accumulation, and it worsens with rate. As you go faster and faster, the diffusional equilibrium becomes more and more of a problem. Sodium-potassium channels that are in the T-tubules are a different type than the ones on the plasma membrane. They try to accommodate, but they don't always keep up. I think Don Baer's had some very interesting studies on the type of sodium-potassium ATPases in the two regions, or not the different isoforms. And that had another possible impact. So it's just a very, very complex relationship.
That I mean, if you look at the
doctor, part of that part.
Right. I'd like to, but I probably can't. I think it may be related to the total volume of the T-tubule, right, compared to the surface membrane. It's going to be very small. So in terms of the overall membrane potential change because of K accumulation, I would suspect it's going to be a very small change.
Well, that's these other guys were looking for. I think
it may not be zero, but yeah. I mean, it can't be enormous. Let me go to the question of triggered waves. So, what you're looking at now is the surface of a rat ventricle, and you can see columns of cells that are joined end to end. And now I'm simulating at rapid cycles of 360. And you see it's getting calcium transients for
very stimulating.
Stimulating at the so I'm recording from the sort of middle of the LV, and I'm stimulating toward sort of near the LV apex.
So you're stimulating the ventricle?
Yes.
Not the sinus?
No. This is ventricular pulse. Okay. The point, quickly, was that you're getting uniform calcium release. Now, this is what happens in a failing ventricle. This is rat. Okay, so you can see the underlying pacing at 700 milliseconds, right? Everything is kind of flashing. But you're also seeing this extraordinary calcium wave behavior. And this will stop in a moment, and you'll see what happens to that wave behavior. It all goes away. Right. Now you'll see an occasional, after a rest, you'll see some occasional spontaneous rest. Did everybody see what I was talking about? Yes, no? Because it's sort of critical to this question of how they become arrhythmogenic. So this is what we call triggered calcium waves. They're not spontaneous calcium waves. They only occur during the action potential. So I don't know how many of you are aware of the distinction here, but think of the distinction because it's quite important to understanding the next few slides. We discovered it in an atrial cell, and here's an atrial myocyte. This is a little bit long, but here you can actually see the activation, this pacing at 700 milliseconds. You can see the activation at the periphery, and then the spread of calcium into the interior of the cell. Right? Nobody see that? So this is normal activation of the atrial cell. It's totally different from ventricle. This is an isolated cell. Now we're going to go at some point to rapid pacing. There's a loop where the 10 minutes is expired. There we go. All right, so you can still see it activates at the periphery. Look what happens. You're getting these triggered calcium waves. And this is distinct from spontaneous waves, because as soon as you stop the pacing, you're seeing tons of triggered waves. Stop the pacing, all goes away.
But not necessarily immediately.
As soon as the pacing is done.
So there's no reactive activity.
This is dog, right?
This is dog atrium.
This is dog.
This is dog atrium. In the two-dimensional, it was rat ventricle. That's right. That's where we first saw it. We don't see it in isolated myocytes at all.
And that's only in heart failure.
Heart failure
dog. Sorry. Yes.
Heart failure rat. Heart failure dog.
Yeah,
that's right.
And without heart failure, you don't see the extra. Is rate enough to cause that?
I will get into that in a moment. So what we did was we quantified these trigger waves, and you can see them here. This is a line scan image in normal ventricular and heart failure, and we see a small incidence of normal ventricular myocytes where we see these triggered waves, but it's much higher in the heart failure ventricular myocytes. So about 20% of normal ventricular myocytes produce these trigger calcium waves, and about 60% of heart failure. This is a sort of expanded scale. You can see the type of behavior we're talking about, right? So this is what it looks like on a line scan. You've seen it on a 2D movie, and it's pretty impressive in a 2D movie. But here you can see this behavior in the ventricle. And you can see it's wave-like, right? It's a normal calcium transient. You have an abrupt calcium release and recovery. Here you have a true wave. They're all at an angle, which means that they are propagating along the cell length. Okay, so what we did, the question that I asked is this the result of T-tubule loss, these triggered waves? So I used formamide to detubulate, and I basically, and it was very effective in detubulating, so here you have 2D, so here you have a very well detubulated formamide treated cell. And even after acute detubulation, now you have all sorts of beautiful triggered waves, and the incidence is virtually identical to that in heart failure. So I did this formamide experiment to determine whether the detubulation alone in heart failure could be sufficient to produce these triggered waves. As far as I can determine, the answer is yes. It's the detubulation. It's not some other process that's related to heart failure.
Yes. So these triggered waves, do they affect the patient?
The answer is no, that the SR is not overloaded. It has to do with poor release. And so the SR load is very high, but it's not really overloaded. So it's actually release is suppressed. Normal release is suppressed. Because you haven't got as much P2-wheel, less activation, poorer release, calcium accumulation. It's not really a truly SR overload problem.
Yeah.
It's kind of like a local overload.
Sometimes you have some release that is larger than normal.
At least that's how we're interpreting it.
So this is not a delayed ventricularization.
It is not a delayed
ventricularization.
It's
not early.
It's early. It is during the action potential. So it is, you know, we're now thinking about EADs, but really, here I want to get finally to the electrophysiology. I'll talk about how we think it's truly arrhythmogenic, because it occurs during the action potential. Although many have occurred, you know, between action potentials, it's an action potential phenomenon, and it disappears when you stop pacing, and that's what distinguishes it. Not a DAD-related phenomenon. Phase 3. EADs, possibly prolongation of the APD, as you'll see in a moment, and so forth. Okay. So here we have, after much pain and suffering in dog atrial myocytes, we made some recordings of the action potential, which is surprisingly difficult. So here's your average calcium signal down here, and here is, you can see these beautiful trigger waves that occur during pacing. If you look at the calcium signal, it goes way up as a result of this enormously bright signal. And look what happens to the resting potential in both of these action potentials. And it virtually follows every single one of these waves. And if you then superimpose, it's, you know, we used to talk about a potassium battery. Do you remember this when we were talking about potassium batteries for the resting potential? This is basically a sodium-calcium exchange battery in the produces a huge depolarization. And if you look at the magnitude of depolarization as a function of change in calcium, you can get 30 millimoles changes more than 30 millimoles changes in resting potential in the atrium because of these trigger waves during the action potential.